In the previous episode, after the Three Kingdoms were established, the loyal minister of Su, Zhuge Liang, launched 5 expeditions to challenge the much stronger Kingdom of Wei. Despite his genius and persistence, he was outlasted by his rival Sima Yi. With him gone, we are entering the final arc of the novel, the end of the Three Kingdoms. This is the part rarely included in various adaptations of the novel. The true ending that is too heart-wrenching for most audiences. But if you want to know how the novel truly ends, then prepare your hankies and keep watching. Having outlasted Zhuge Liang, the Wei mastermind Sima Yi went on to conquer the last warlord to the north, Gongsun Yuan. With these achievements under his belt, he became tremendously influential and also gained the envy of many, many rivals in court. When the ruler of Wei, Cao Rui, died, Sima Yi was chosen to be the regent of the new young emperor, Cao Fang. But to balance against his influence, Cao Shuang, the son of Sima Yi's former superior, was made a co-regent. Cao Shuang didn't get along with Sima Yi, who thought that his father was an imbecile. So he used political maneuvers to isolate his rival, forcing Sima Yi to pretend illness and resign from office with his sons. His political exile would last for 10 years. Here we see the meritocratic ideals of Wei had turned into political backstabbing. The last 15 chapters of Romance of the Three Kingdoms is a one long arc of suffering. There are no more superhuman generals, brilliant strategists, or epic battles. The focus has shifted to Machiavellian palace intrigues and corruption. After 105 chapters of upward empire-building trajectory, we are now going into the downward trajectory where we see the kingdoms our heroes worked so hard to build fall due to the very same ideals they are founded on. This is a very tough arc to read. It is not surprising that most adaptations do not include these chapters, but they are actually a very integral part of this novel. You will see why by the end. After a 10 years time skip, we find a sickly Sima Yi in bed. Cao Shuang had been sending his minions to keep tabs on Sima Yi to make sure that he remained harmless. But one fateful day in the year 249, after Cao Shuang's underling left, the seemingly frail Sima Yi leapt out of bed and launched a coup. He had been waiting for the right opportunity for a very long time. Cao Shuang and the emperor's visit to the imperial tomb had left the palace undefended. So Sima Yi secured the palace easily and offered his co-regent the chance to surrender peacefully. Cao Shuang will only be deprived of his military authority, he promised. But once he did surrender, his whole family was exterminated. Then, as if history was repeating itself, Sima Yi made the young emperor of Wei his puppet. From here on, the Kingdom of Wei was just an empty shell ruled by the Sima family. Cao Cao once said that he would rather betray the world than let it betray him. But it looks like the world finally got its last laugh as his descendant was betrayed by Sima Yi. This usurpation wasn't a popular move. There were still a lot of people who were loyal to Cao Cao and his family, and it will take a long time until the Sima family can win the people and the officers over. This event also led to the defection of Xiahou Ba to Su. Capitalizing on this upheaval, the grand commander of Su Han, Jiang Wei, then used the opportunity to launch a campaign to conquer Wei. This would be his fourth campaign. After the death of his mentor, Zhuge Liang, Jiang Wei had continued to launch costly northern campaigns in a futile effort to conquer Cao Wei. While his persistence and respect for his mentor's legacy was commendable, his campaigns drained the kingdom's resources. It also didn't help that his ruler had become a self-indulgent buffoon that spent most of his time wasting his treasury's money and associating with corrupt officials and eunuchs. This campaign was another failure. Historically, he will launch a total of 11 failed campaigns. But in the novel, which used a different counting method, counted 9 campaigns. Su Han's brand of brotherhood and loyalty had turned into blind loyalty. Sima Yi died a couple of years after the coup, and his son Sima Si and Sima Zhao continued their family's control over the emperor. When Sun Quan died the next year, Wei took the opportunity to launch a war against Wu, but they were defeated. The three kingdoms will remain deadlocked for quite some time. These battles fought by mediocre generals had become quite uninteresting. You can even say that they have become quite procedural with no conclusive results. The star commanders of Wei, Deng Ai to the west and Zhong Hui to the east, will soon enter the fray, but even they don't offer much excitement. Wu had its own problems too. After the death of Sun Quan, the country was run by Zhuge Ke, a cruel prime minister who was eventually assassinated by his political rivals. Here we see Wu's loyal family retainers had turned into evil officials. As we progress through the chapters, we can see the wheels of history looping over and over again. When the Emperor of Wei tried to get rid of Sima Si through a secret edict, the plot was discovered just like what happened to Cao Cao decades earlier. The Emperor was then deposed and replaced by a new one. Emperors had become so expendable here, I'm placing a number next to them so that you can keep a better track of them. This unpopular move launched a revolution, and Sima Si died around this time due to complication after his eye surgery. He was then replaced by his brother Sima Zhao. Meanwhile, as Jiang Wei continued to launch his failed expeditions, Deng Ai, who successfully defended against him, rose in fame and prominence. So did Zhong Hui, who quashed a rebel who collaborated with Wu. After their defeat, a lot of their officers defected to Cao Wei, because their new prime minister, Sun Chen, was another cruel and brutal man. He deposed the second Wu emperor, Sun Liang, and replaced him with Sun Xiu. The third emperor was so scared of him, he ended up launching a preemptive coup and executed him. So much for Sun family values, eh? To the west, Jiang Wei's campaign finally showed signs of progress. He used his mentor Zhuge Liang's 8 array formation to defeat Deng Ai in battle. But before he could finish him off, Huang Hao, a eunuch trusted by Liu San, the Emperor of Su, was bribed into recalling Jiang Wei's force back to the capital. Just like the Han dynasty they tried to revive, the eunuchs were running Su Han into the ground. This last-minute recall would happen multiple times through his campaigns. In one occasion, Jiang Wei was called back because another general wanted the credit for winning a battle. But that general even ended up chickening out when he had to face Deng Ai. If you think that it is about time to end their misery, then you are not the only one who has this idea. Sima Zhao finally pulled up his resources and sent the combined forces of his best generals, Deng Ai and Zhong Hui, to conquer Su. But he was also wary of this too. They had become quite influential and they might just launch their own rebellion, especially the ambitious Zhong Hui. When Jiang Wei caught wind of this, he immediately requested reinforcement. But the eunuch Huang Hao refused to send Jiang Wei any reinforcements because he thought that it was just his excuse to launch a coup. By now, even the ghost of Zhuge Liang thought that Su Han was beyond help. He visited Zhong Hui in his dream and told him that the mandate of heaven was lost, and he requested the commander to show mercy to the population of Su. If you are not crying yet, then this next bit might just do the trick. Left with no one to defend the capital, Liu San begged Zhuge Liang's son to lead an army against the Wei invaders. Oh, they thought that he would live up to his father's legacy. But no. He was tricked and defeated by the simplest trick in the book. His father's legacy was utterly and embarrassingly crushed. Thus, he committed suicide out of shame. In the year 264, the kingdom of Su Han fell. Its ruler, Liu San, had surrendered to Deng Ai. Jiang Wei surrendered to his opponent, Zhong Hui. However, this loyal officer wasn't about to give up just yet, despite everything. He made a last-ditch attempt to save the kingdom even if his lord couldn't give a damn about it. He pretended to show allegiance to Zhong Hui and drove a wedge between him and Deng Ai. He convinced the ambitious Zhong Hui to rebel and start his own kingdom. It worked. Deng Ai was arrested and he was being delivered to the Wei's capital as prisoner. But Zhong Hui didn't have the support of his officers. When he coerced them to show their allegiance, they mutinied and killed him. Jiang Wei tried to defend himself in the ensuing chaos. However, the aging general suffered a heart attack at the last moment and perished as he was being overrun. Deng Ai was killed as he was being transferred. As for Liu San, he ended up living a comfortable life as a minor noble under Sima Zhao. He was treated well to encourage Wu to surrender in the future. He never dropped a single tear for his lost kingdom or even his favorite eunuch who was executed. After Sima Zhao died, Sima Yan came into power. Like Cao Cao, Sima Zhao did not make himself the emperor for the sake of stability, but he was preparing his son to take the position. So in 266, the Jing Dynasty was established and its first official ruler was Sima Yan. Posthumously, Sima Yi was given the honorable title of first emperor. In case you're wondering, it is a very confusing thing to bestow the honor of the first emperor to one's parent or ancestor. After preparing for a few years, the Jing Dynasty went on to conquer Wu. The ruler of Wu at the time, Sun Hao, was cruel, tyrannical, and corrupt. So he wasn't the kind of ruler people want to defend. When the Jing army approached the capital, only the prime minister and his men stood against the invaders. Out of shame, because it would be so sad if the capital was conquered without a single person dying to defend it. Well, he got his wish. While his ruler surrendered and licked his conqueror's boot like a dog. Oh man, talk about a heart-wrenching 15 chapters of complete annihilation of everything that was built up by the novel. You can see why most adaptations leave this bit out. But leaving this part in is actually the very genius of this novel. Empires rise, empires fall, and this novel carries you through all the motions. It simulated the exhilaration of empire building, the difficulty to maintain it, and also the devastating fall. Each of the three kingdoms is a fractal in the greater curve of history. The very ideals and foundations these empires were built upon could also be the cause of their fall. What many people don't realize is that each Chinese dynasty had their own unique policies and philosophies. What made them great could also be the cause of their fall. The openness and cosmopolitanism of the Tang Dynasty, for example, expanded the empire greatly. But it also made the tragedy of An Lushan's rebellion possible. There is no system or policy that is perfect. Yet, the empire long united must divide. Long divided must unite. People will continue to try to build their empire and utopia. But now that you have read Romance of the Three Kingdoms, maybe you have become a little wiser to the possible weaknesses of your own ideals. It is easy to think that other people are wrong, but perhaps we don't have the right answer either. Alright, that's it for the Romance of the Three Kingdoms summary. Before I end the video, let me congratulate you for finally finishing the novel. Now you know the novel's true ending. I would also like to thank you all for watching the series and also our illustrator, Ray, for illustrating all these wonderful characters. On this channel, we make contents on the history and culture of East Asia and other parts of the world. If this sounds like your jam, then subscribe to get more. You can also support us on Patreon if you like what we are doing. Until next time, stay cool, my bros!